In this video, we begin discussing salt solutions. So far in this chapter, we have discussed acids and bases. And again, the best recommendation I can make as you're working with problems or trying to figure out how to set up a problem is to be able to label a substance. So again, so far we have discussed strong acids, strong bases, weak acids, and weak bases. With our discussion of salt solutions, we begin with a reminder that salts are actually produced as the product of acid-base reactions. So if you remember from first semester, when you were discussing reaction types, we often said that acid-base reactions will produce salt and water. And even though we're producing salts, they don't all have a neutral pH. As we get into our discussion of salts, we will get into calculations of pHs of salt solutions. On this slide, we're going to practice by predicting the products of these four acid-base reactions. I encourage you to pause the video and predict the products. When you have them predicted, resume the video. All right, so we will go through and discuss the products of each one of these reactions. So, of course, these are all double replacement or double displacement reactions where we can predict products by having our cations or anions swap places. For our first one, the salt that we will form is NaCl. In this one, we do form water from the combination of the hydrogen from the acid and the hydroxide from the base. In our second example, the salt that we form will be from the combination of the cation in KOH with the anion in HF. And so our salt will be KF. Again, we do form water as the product here. In our third example, notice that we no longer have a hydroxide base here. Our base is the weak base of ammonia. So I can't form water anymore because I no longer have the Arrhenius base. In this one, we essentially are carrying out or predicting products as a combination reaction. And so technically the salt that we're forming is ammonium nitrate. We don't form water here, again, because we don't have a hydroxide base. In our fourth reaction, similar idea here. We again have ammonia as our weak base. We don't have hydroxide, so I won't form water. Our product here will be the product of a combination reaction. And so my cation will be the ammonium ion, and then my anion is the acetate ion. Notice in this fourth one, this one actually sets up equilibrium. And it does that because of the nature of the acid and base that were used to make this salt, the strength of those. So the next thing that we want to discuss is to be able to label the strength of the acid and base that made each salt. Recognizing our first example, we have a strong base with a strong acid. That combination will produce a salt that is predicted to be neutral. And so we predict a pH of 7 for that salt. In our second example, we have a strong base with a weak acid. In this combination, we predict our salt to be basic, to have a pH that's higher than 7 because of the strength of our strong base. In our third example, we have a weak base combining with a strong acid. Because we have the strong acid here, we will predict that this salt is going to be acidic, that it will have a low pH. In the fourth one, we'll address this one later on in our videos. This one is more challenging to predict. We actually have to perform calculations because both substances, both our base and our acid, are weak. We would have to perform calculations to predict. So again, that will be coming later. The other thing to recognize as we discuss salt solutions is being able to recognize one. So recognize that salts are ionic compounds. Most of them are metal with a non-metal, but notice in our last two examples, we don't have a metal here. We have just the cation of ammonium. And so again, an ionic compound is made up of a cation with an anion. So usually we have a metal as the cation. So a metal or a cation would be combined with a non-metal slash anion. So technically, we do combine a cation with an anion to make salts. A second way to recognize a salt solution is process of elimination. Again, so far in this chapter, we've discussed acids, we have discussed bases, and now we're discussing salts. So if a solution is not an acid or a base, it would then have to be a salt. Another thing to recognize in all of our salt solutions, the cation in each salt always comes from the base. So if I give you just a salt solution, for example, sodium chloride, if I want to figure out the acid and base that made it, I take my sodium cation and add a hydroxide to it. That will tell me the base that gave me that cation, and then I can evaluate the strength of that base. And so, of course, by process of elimination, the anion in a salt will always come from the acid. And so, looking at chloride, I would tack an H plus onto the front of that chloride to determine the strength of the acid that gave me chloride. And a review of the strength of conjugates of acid and bases. Remember that a strong acid completely ionizes in water, like HCl. Because this reaction goes to completion, we just get the chloride ion in solution. That chloride ion, because HCl is a strong acid, this is a very, very weak conjugate base. Actually, let me rewrite that. This is a weak conjugate base. On the other hand, a weak acid such as HF will set up equilibrium. And so when we produce fluoride in solution, this is a relatively strong conjugate base. And so anytime we have fluoride ion floating around in solution, as the product of the dissociation of a salt, for example, that will react with water to produce hydroxide in solution. So again, fluoride will act as a base. It is the conjugate base of HF, and that's confirmed when we see that it produces hydroxide. As we predict the pHs of salt solutions, it is also helpful to be able to understand what the ions in a salt will do in water. So, in other words, as we just discussed, chloride in water will have no reaction because it is not a base. It is a very, very weak base. There will be no reaction. However, fluoride would react in water as a base. And so we can actually label ions from salts, both the cations and the anions, based on what they will do in water, whether they would act as an acid, base, or neutral. Any anion that comes from a strong acid, like chloride, are considered to be neutral. They do not hydrolyze, and hydrolyze means reacting in water. So all anions that come from strong acids are neutral, and they are also called spectator ions. Remember from Chem 151 or first semester chemistry, spectator ions are the ones that don't react. They don't react because they are neutral. So this is where you really need to know your strong acids list. Recognize that we have seven strong acids, and so the anions, the conjugate bases of those strong acids, are going to be neutral. So there are then seven neutral anions, of course, chloride being one. So all of your anions from strong bases will be considered neutral or spectator. Again, you should recognize these by formula or by name. And the last one that I'm going to list here is technically true, but recognize that hydrogen sulfate is the conjugate base of sulfuric acid. And this one I don't typically use in examples. It's too confusing to see. Students often predict sulfate, but sulfate would actually be a relatively strong conjugate base. So technically, hydrogen sulfate is in the list, but I don't use it for practical purposes. And so on this slide and in your notes, here we have our list of our neutral anions. By the same token, cations that come from strong bases are also neutral. Remember that these cations from strong bases we don't call conjugates because they come from Arrhenius bases. So these are literally just going to be cations. They are all going to be metals. And again, they are called spectator ions because they are neutral and won't react in water. They won't hydrolyze. We, of course, know that our cations from strong bases, there will be eight of these. And again, the cations here are the ones that we would list from our periodic table from groups one and two. Not necessarily listing in order, but our five group one cations. And then remember, we have the three group two. So these are your eight neutral cations because they come from a strong base. Same justification and rationale as our anions, but they don't have conjugates. And again, here is our list of those neutral cations. So these are the anions and cations that are neutral. And so hopefully it makes sense that if we have a cation or anion that comes from a weak base or a weak acid, these are the ions that will hydrolyze, in other words, react with water, that will cause a shift in pH because they will act as acids or bases. So our cations that come from a weak base will act as an acid because they will be the conjugate acid of that weak base. Similarly, anions that come from weak acids will act as conjugate bases, or will be conjugate bases, and therefore will act as bases in solution. We'll dive into that concept in more detail in the next video.